Whenever you are buying a kit, it's always a good practice that once you open the packaging of the kit, first of all, you're gonna dump all the small components into some small container so that you are not losing any of the small bits and pieces. Then you're gonna definitely need the instruction manual of what you are supposed to do with the build. And it's also a good idea to go through the list of components if it is provided and actually check that you get the components. So I have checked and all the components are there. What I'm mainly, of course, interested in is the small printed circuit board and the op-amp. About the rest, I don't really care. I mean, I have all the other components laying around, plenty of them. Nevertheless, I'm happy that all the components are here. So then we can actually put together this thing. Let's go. So what I do most of the time is that first of all, I'm gonna install the smallest components, namely the resistors, because they're gonna then sit really nice and flat on the board. And also, I like to install the resistors first because that means that you will still have plenty of space to install taller components. And also, whenever you are installing the resistors, you know that they do not have any polarity. So it means that it doesn't matter, you know, whether they are sitting like this or in the other way around in the board. That's absolutely not a problem. Whereas, in stark contrast to that, electrolytic capacitors, they do have a polarity, so you cannot just, put them in the board as you like. No, I will show you how to put them in. And it's the same with the op-amp as well. It does have a polarity, and if you rotate it wrong when you put it in the board, then you're gonna get the magic smoke escaping, which is never a good thing whenever you are working with some electronic components. When you are installing the components, it's a good idea then to have the manual and also the board next to one each other so that you can see then the circuit diagram and of course the PCB itself, so that you know which component belongs to which place. Furthermore, notice that here as an example in this manual, you even have the color coding for the given resistors very nicely described. So even if you do not know which code is corresponding to what kind of resistor values, no problem, you can just look them up and populate then the board accordingly. So then to put in the resistors, all I do is just simply take a resistor, then bend the leads, okay, with my hand. Then I just look it up, where does it belong? So this is a 47 kilo ohm resistor for an example, and this should be then R2. R1 is already being populated, so I just nicely push in the component through the holes. I push then the component down with my finger, nicely clicks into place because there is a springiness in the leads. Then I rotate the board over, so I hold the component actually with my finger down, okay. Then I use this flat tool here. So notice that this is not cutting anything. So it's really nice. You can just take the lead, okay, and then push it on a bit to the side. I don't know how well you can see it. So it will then nicely make a close to 90 degree bend on in the lead, and after doing the same thing with this tool on the other side of the resistor as you see now, both of the leads of the resistor are close to 90 degrees bend, so they are no longer falling out of the board no matter what we do. I mean, we can really go rough on it, because those things are on there. Using then the same methodology, I will then populate now all the resistors, and then I'll be back.
After you have populated all the resistors on the board, it's a good idea to again check that you have the right resistors at the right places. Okay. And once you are sure that they are the right things, then you can go ahead and then actually solder the resistors in and then cut the leads down, because otherwise, as you see, it's gonna become very much like a densely, you know, populated forest. So you will simply not have space anymore to put in capacitors and other things. So this is why, at least personally, I find it better to first then solder the resistors, cut the legs off. And this is because if you first solder the resistors now, cut the leads off, then you will have a close to flat board again, with which you can easily work with to then put in the capacitors and the integrated circuits and other things. I mean, in this case, this is a really simple board. But anyway, I found that even on larger boards, that is the best practice most of the time. And also putting in the most expensive parts, it's a good idea to do them last and not first or in the middle of the build, because you can either electrostatically kill them, or you can just overheat the board and kill the most expensive component, which you definitely do not want to do. So this is why I first put in the cheapest things, check that everything is fine, and only last put in the real active components. In this case, it's just an op amp, so it's €1. It's not really an expensive part, but nevertheless. By the way, regarding this bending of the leads with this flat tool here, please notice that I'm not just, you know, bending the leads randomly. Let me zoom in a little so I can explain a bit better. By bending the leads in some particular directions, I mean that I do take care of the fact that I do not want to make undesired shorts once I'm soldering the components into place. Namely, as an example, if I would bend now, you know, this leg in that direction, okay, then I would come very close to a short circuit, which I might not notice. And this is why I have bent the lead in a slightly different direction. And I was doing this all over the board, except as an example in this situation. I mean, just, yeah, right there, okay. And that is because that is anyway a trace on the board, so it is not a problem that the two leads are touching one each other. But notice here, in contrast, as an example, that this lead is bent in this direction here and not in this direction, okay, because then that would come very close to this solder joint here, what we do not really wanna do. After all the resistors have been nicely populated, then I just take the syringe with the flux. I gently push it to get a bit of flux at the very tip of the syringe. And then I just touch the given places up where I'm gonna then do the soldering. So let's go over the full board. Then after you are done with the fluxing of the resistors, then we can go ahead and do the soldering. I'm using here on iron temperature of roughly, yeah, it's 285 degrees. This should work just fine. And you just make a nice solder bead on all the resistors. And after I'm done with them, I'll bead them back. So then here we have the resistors soldered. And then we can go ahead and snip off the excess legs of these through-hole components. And once we are done with that, then we can check whether we have done a good job or not. Upon inspecting the solder joints, they look fine to me. So that means that we can continue and we can then populate the capacitors now. Next. Regarding the capacitors, we need to be more careful because they do have a polarity. Namely, if you check one of the electrolytic capacitors, as an example here, you're gonna see that one of the sides is marked. Most of the time is the negative side, which is being marked by the manufacturer. So this is why you see this small little minus sign right there. And this minus sign is then aligned to one of the legs, okay? And that means that the other side of the capacitor then has to be positive. In this case, there is no marking on the positive side. And there are some manufacturers which actually mark the positive side and not the negative side like here. So yeah, please take care, because if you check the motherboard, as an example, let us have a look on C3. So as you see, next to the C3, there is a plus sign right there, which means that we do have to populate it such that the positive side of this electrolytic capacitor comes to the plus side of this C3 right here, okay? Because if we don't respect this, then most probably we're gonna explode the capacitor, and that's never a good sign. Let us then stick to the example of C3, which is a 10 microfarad electrolytic capacitor. So first of all, then check which capacitor is 10 microfarad. So this is the right one. That's the first thing. Whenever you are populating capacitors, that's what you do. You get the right value, first of all, in your hand. After you check that it is the right value and also the right voltage, in this case it doesn't matter because we are using a 9-volt battery, but nevertheless, so once you have the right capacitor in your hand, then you're gonna look up which is the positive side. So in most of the cases it's the longer lead, but yeah, as I mentioned, please check which mark is on the capacitor by the manufacturer. So this is the negative side right here, okay? So then we know that the other one here, the longer one, is the positive side. So then we're just gonna take the longer one, and then we're gonna put it in where there is the plus sign shown on the PCB. There you go. And once you do this, then I'm gonna then do the same thing with this flat tool, just like I did with the resistors, so that the capacitors are not falling out of the board whenever I'm turning the board around. After I have populated all the capacitors and I have bent the leads on the other side of the PCB, first of all, I do not yet have soldered them in, because at this stage I still check again whether I have the right polarity. So again, at this stage I'm not checking anymore whether they are the right value, because that should have been done in the previous step. At this stage, all I'm looking at is whether I have the, where the plus sign is actually the positive part of the electrolytic capacitor. And this can be done rather quickly. And I can tell you that even after years of putting stuff together, people do make mistakes. And at this stage, sometimes I do find, as an example, that by mistake, I just change the polarity of some of the electrolytic caps. So it's good to find this thing before you actually solder them into place. And if you find that everything is all right, then you can go ahead, then apply the MTech or whatever flux you have, and solder the capacitors in, just as you did with the resistors. Then cut off the leads with the side cutter, and at that stage, then I'll be back with the rest of the video. Here is then the board with the electrolytic capacitors being soldered in. So all what we are missing now is then one non-polarized capacitor, which is C4 right there. Probably they on purpose chose that, you know, like on Meatbusters, they say that if there is not enough meats, there is just more C4. Anyway, so C4 is, as I mentioned, it's not a polarized capacitor. It doesn't matter how you rotate it. That's what means that it does not have a polarization. This is why, if you look, there are just two parallel lines on the board. There is no positive or negative sign put anywhere. So we can just drop the capacitor in. And after we have dropped it in, we bend the leads, solder it down, rinse and repeat. So now we are then just missing the op-amp here and the two potentiometers and the small turrets, which then lead to the power, the input, the microphone here, and the output right there. So as remember I said that it's a good idea to put in the most expensive component last, and that is actually what we will do. However, considering how tall these potentiometers are, then first we're gonna actually just build in this socket for the op-amp, and these are dirt cheap, so even if we do something wrong, it's absolutely no problem. And because this is not as tall as the potentiometers right here, and if we would populate now the potentiometers, then it would be a bit more tricky to put in the socket for the op-amp. So let us then put in the socket. And please notice that there is a small, teeny tiny cutout right there on the top of the socket, okay? And notice that also on the PCB, there is also a sign right there. So it means that you should then put in the socket such that it matches this notch marked on the PCB. And by the way, if you're wondering what's this noise, it's a nice torrential rain. It's kind of needed. It was quite dry here. So I'm not gonna stop the video just because of that. We're gonna keep on going through the rain. We have then the IC socket in, soldered in. So it's time to put in the two potentiometers. And regarding now these standoffs or turrets, as you wish to call them. Regarding these small turrets which come with the kit, I mean, personally, I prefer to directly solder the audio leads into the output and especially into the microphone input. So I will not be using these small needles or turrets, I don't know how you call them. I will then instead just directly solder the leads in. Of course, coming then from this female type audio jack here that will come to the microphone input. And then the other lead, I cannot find it, of course. Yeah, once I find it, I show it to you. So that will then go here to the audio output. But first then let us put in the two potentiometers so we can call the board more or less finished. Here then P1 is a 1 kilo ohm potentiometer, which as I explained is then gonna be used to set the gain of this amplifier microphone preamplifier board. And the gain then will be roughly 150 and 1000, depending on the value of this resistor. Anyway, in order to put it in the board, you just look up where is the P1. You select the 1 kilo ohm potentiometer. It's explicitly written on the potentiometer 1K in this case. And yeah, I mean, there is no way to put it in backwards. And you're just gonna play the same game. So here then the potentiometers are being soldered in, and I actually made a line with a marker so that you can see that some manufacturers sent the potentiometers in different, you know, settings. Anyway, so as you see this line here, there is this arrow inside. So practically if we now rotate this with a small screwdriver, then we can set here then the gain. And if we rotate this one, we can get the input amplitude selected. Since this is a audio preamplifier, we don't really know what will work, but since we just want to test at the beginning whether this thing is working at all, it's a good idea to set the potentiometers roughly in the middle. So as you see, here then the arrow is right in the roughly in the middle of the potentiometers. So first we just gonna build this thing and test it. So now we gonna then solder the leads into the input and the output, and we're gonna also solder the power leads as well. And yeah, I mean, this is just for testing. Once we test it out and we know whether it works, first of all, and what are the right settings for the potentiometers and so forth, then we're gonna actually have to desolder the input and output leads, because we want to build this thing into this box right here. Okay, so then let's do it. For this negative pole here, actually I'm gonna build in one of these turrets. I'm gonna solder it in, because at this point we're gonna have to have both the negative side of the battery soldered on, and also the shielding of the audio cable